A toddler chewed lead paint off his toys. This is what happened to his brain. JP is a 4-year-old boy presenting to the emergency room with a steady decline in coordination, appetite, and speech. His mother, Sarah, tells the admitting nurse that he had lost 5 pounds over the last week and had developed tremors in his hands. JP was from a well-off family living in an old house. He loved playing with antique toys given to him by grandma. About a year ago, Sarah realized that JP was chewing the paint off his toys. He seemed happy and healthy, so she didn't think too much of it. She replaced the toys with a different set, and life continued on. But as the weeks went by, Sarah noticed that JP's attention span was shortening. Maybe she'd limit his screen time, she thought. Sometimes she'd call out his name and he clearly couldn't hear her. Maybe she should speak louder, she thought. Eventually, Sarah found her son chewing the paint off his new toys. She took those away too, but this time, things didn't seem right. JP complained his tummy hurt. Sarah thought his walk looked funny. His speech started to slur. His hands began to tremble. His reaction time seemed to be blunted. Sarah realized then that something terribly wrong was happening to her son, and clinical exam confirms this. Hyperactive behavior was found in JP along with ataxia. A meaning without and taxia meaning order. His movements were uncoordinated with a marked tremor in his upper extremities. High-frequency sensory neural hearing loss was detected. Higher-pitched sounds were almost inaudible to JP. Urine analysis revealed excessive proteinuria, indicating kidney damage. A blood test reveals JP's blood lead level is over 200 micrograms per deciliter, at least 40 times the level known to cause brain damage. Clearly, his neurologic decline is because of lead poisoning, but something's wrong. Typically, symptoms of lead poisoning are resolved after exposure has ceased. Sarah took his toys away weeks ago, but his condition is worsening. JP's lead toxicity is chronic, meaning he had a constant exposure over a long time, and this excessive buildup has started to permanently damage him. We can prove this. We estimate his total blood volume to be about a liter, given his weight of 14 kilograms measured at admission. So there's really over 2,000 micrograms of lead total in his blood. But studies indicate that less than 25% of absorbed lead is in the blood. So where is that other 75%? Well, there's some basic chemistry to be known here. Lead is a heavy metal. On the periodic table, it's a member of group 14, so it shares some characteristics with carbon, silicon, and tin. As you go down the group, the atomic mass of each element increases. Heavier elements are less stable. Less stable means more reactive, and more reactive means that lead preferentially binds to structures in the body, explaining that other 75%. But elemental group 14 members tend to be inert in the body, meaning they don't react with anything. Have you ever heard of metallic tin poisoning? Because I haven't. How about the silica gel that you find in packages that say do not eat? That's silicon dioxide. I've seen people choke on it, but I haven't seen that silicon react with anything in the body. So let's go back to the chemistry. Group 14 elements can have a positive 4 charge, something that we call a tetravalent cation. Tetra meaning 4. Valent from Latin valentia meaning capacity, and cation meaning a positive charge, like something that you see on batteries. One reason why chemical reactions happen is to eliminate the charge, so making it 0 makes it stable. So to get rid of +4, you really need a -4. But nothing in the body is -4, so carbon, silicon, germanium, and tin don't really react with anything in the body, but lead is an exception. Its significance is because of how heavy it is. The number of particles at the center, or the nucleus, is called the atomic number. Silicon is 14, germanium is 32, so that difference is 18. Tin is 50, also a difference of 18, but lead is 82, a difference of 32. This means that there's a lot more particles in lead's nucleus. More particles means more mass, and more mass means stronger forces pulling towards the center. So instead of +4, lead is actually +2, something that we call a divalent cation, and this explains why lead is toxic in humans. As divalent lead flows throughout JP's body, it mimics and competes with other divalent cations, which are calcium, magnesium, and zinc, important components of muscle contraction, cellular signaling, and nerve conduction. So as lead displaces these necessary cations, it blocks twists, and warps everything that it touches. Lead preferentially binds to sulfhydryl groups, a binding of sulfur and hydrogen. These are everywhere in proteins, which are the functional structures of cells. So as lead disturbs these sulfhydryl groups, the proteins fold abnormally and no longer function as intended, meaning that cells start to die. Nerves are irreversibly damaged. Lead displaces calcium at the point of synapse in nerve cells still alive, shutting down their signals too. As lead continues to creep into JP's tissues, the cell death proliferates to his brain. Divalent lead drives itself deeper into mitochondria, disturbing brain cell metabolism, uncoupling ATP production in the brain, leading to hypometabolism, and ending in permanent brain damage for JP because of lead paint that he chewed off his toys. If 2,000 micrograms in blood is actually just 25%, then there's really more than 8,000 micrograms of lead floating around in his body. Given that just 200 micrograms is known to cause permanent brain damage, and that his neurologic condition is quickly deteriorating, JP is in trouble. Can we somehow remove that lead from his body? Maybe. This brings us back to divalent cations. Your body removes chemicals through a process called excretion. Waste is eliminated by dissolving it in water as the kidneys filter the blood and concentrate the urine. The problem with lead is that it accumulates in the kidneys, where it collects inside the duct and injures the tubules. And even worse, it stays for more than 120 days, where it accelerates cell death. So, if lead mimics calcium, then we need a molecule already bound to calcium so that lead can displace it. And on the outside, we need the molecule to be water-soluble so it can dissolve and concentrate in the urine. JP is given calcium disodium, ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid. The calcium is swapped by lead on the inside. The outside mixes well with water, allowing it to be removed by the kidneys. He receives several doses, and it's found to be working because JP's blood lead levels decrease rapidly over the next few days, and it's repeated for a few weeks. But it's not enough. Pediatric neurology finds JP's hearing is still impaired. His neurocognitive deficits are still wide. His seizures have stopped, but he's starting to miss developmental milestones. If we remove lead from his blood, what could still be wrong? Less lead is good, right? Well, it is, but at this point, we're only preventing further damage. Removing the lead from his blood doesn't reverse the damage that's already been done. If chelation wasn't given in time, this excess lead would have caused his brain to swell with water, causing cerebral edema. The expansion of his brain would crush up against the skull, smashing blood vessels and ending in death. But luckily, it was caught in time, but the irreversible damage has already been done. At the time of diagnosis, it was thought that maybe the home environment or the water supply could have been the problem, but further analysis showed otherwise. JP's parents had no detectable blood lead levels, so the exposure was isolated to him. Analysis of his toys found paint containing 0.8 weight percent lead. This means that just 1 gram of paint contained the 8,000 microgram level that was found in JP's body, and that he likely chewed more as it had been accumulating in his body over several months. Why was the lead in the paint to begin with? Well, it was commonly added in to dry it faster and to resist moisture and corrosion from a long time ago. That paint is usually common in old art and in old homes, but unfortunately today, lead is still found everywhere in our surroundings and inside everyone too, including you. The European Food Safety Authority in 2010 estimated that the average adult consumer takes in about 0.8 micrograms of lead per kilogram body weight per day from a regular diet. So a 70 kilogram European male takes in about 54 micrograms of lead per day orally. Adults absorb about 1% of lead through their GI tract, so actual amounts that end up in the body are really lower. But where adults do absorb more lead is through the lungs. Lead was added to gasoline as an anti-knockback agent until the 1990s, when unleaded became the law of the land. The 60 years with leaded gas resulted in airborne deposition, so some US urban areas today can classify their soil as hazardous waste because of all the toxic metal in it. Today, we know blood lead levels as low as 5 to 10 micrograms per deciliter, that's less than 5% of JPs, results in permanent IQ loss. Children raised with lead in their blood have reading disabilities, poor hand-eye coordination, longer reaction times with wider neurobehavioral deficits, and in the long term, there's a markedly increased risk of high school dropout and limited job prospects. For JP, it still isn't finished. The largest stores of bodily calcium are not in soft tissue, but in the bone. Because kids grow fast, calcium storage rates are high. When blood lead levels are elevated in these early years, instead of calcium, it's lead that entrenches and embeds itself into the bones. It takes several years for bone to turn over. As JP grows into an adult, that lead will slowly leach out into his blood, serving him a baseline level. During times of acute stress that he'll inevitably live through in his adult life, those lead stores in bone can suddenly unleash a bolus load, poisoning him all over again. If JP was a girl, the bone lead will leach out into her bloodstream during pregnancy and then cross into the fetus, poisoning the child and repeating the cycle all over again. There's no good long-term answer to JP's problems. His acute exposure was addressed with chelation therapy, but that doesn't reverse the damage that was already done over those months that he chewed the lead paint off his toys. This particular patient was lucky that he came from a well-to-do family. It's not even clear if his parents told him that he was poisoned as a kid. Many others aren't so fortunate, but this was a case that was lost to follow-up. More recently, Consumer Reports released an analysis of heavy metal presence in children's fruit juice commercially available. In their analysis, half of the juices tested contained lead concentrations of less than 1 part per billion, that is 1 microgram per liter of juice. Given that children absorb about half of the lead that they consume orally, a child would have to drink 16,000 liters, or 4,226 gallons of juice in one sitting to get to JP's levels. But since we know that less than 1/40th of his levels can cause permanent IQ loss, 50 to 100 gallons of juice doesn't seem implausible for a kid to drink over several months to years because the lead accumulates in the body over time. To be fair, heavy metal levels in US fruit juices have all been going down since the year 2000. The American Academy of Pediatrics recommends parents do not give children under 1 year of age any juice. No more than 4 ounces daily for toddlers aged 1 to 3, no more than 4 to 6 ounces daily for children aged 4 to 6 years, and no more than 8 ounces for children aged 7 to 18 years, because in the end, no blood lead level at all in a child is acceptable. Prevention to any kind of exposure, while easier said than done, is really the best and only way to avert a tragedy like that of JP. Thank you so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.